morning, Facebook.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Is your soul rejoicing in His grace and song? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed?
Yeah.
prayer over our offering this morning. Father God, we just thank you for everyone able to be here and everyone able to being able to gather together and worship and give you thanks and praise. Father, we ask that you would take this offering and multiply and bless it into our community and beyond around our state, our nation, and our world with the message of salvation through faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for this in his name. Amen. And all in the house, do we have any announcements? Stellick funeral Tuesday at 10 o'clock. And that's at?
At the New Legion.
At 9 o'clock, you said?
At
10 o'clock. Funeral, Stellick funeral at 10 o'clock at the New American Legion in Martin, South Dakota. No other announcements? Let's offer up one more word of prayer as we get started this morning. Father God, we just thank you for each of us able to be here this morning. We thank you, Father, for your Holy Spirit coming down and speaking through my mouth to all of our open hearts and our open ears, to your message for each one of us here today. We thank you for this in Jesus' mighty name and for leading and guiding us each day. Amen. So, quick question for everyone here. Has anyone been thirsty over the last few weeks at all? As thirsty as our grass was maybe getting for a while there, it sure seemed like. When I first got said, I get to do this Sunday, I thought, boy, the grass sure seems thirsty. And then lo and behold, some stuff started showing up pretty intensely, didn't it? So maybe the grass isn't quite as thirsty, but it just sparked the thought in my mind of that the lack of something can be such a trial to our faith at times, can't it? You know, not just the lack of physical water for our grass and our flowers and everything, but any time that we have a lack in our life, it can sure test the faith a little bit and put it to trial. In James chapter 1, verses 2-4, we're reminded, "Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any way, any kind, come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing." James 1, 2-4 in the NLT. And I just love that last part of the last sentence there. You will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. That's kind of a big, awesome, yeah, I want to achieve this, God. How do I achieve this goal? And okay, my faith is going to have to go through some testing, so when things get tight and tough, can I remember, okay, you are God, I am not. Can you lead, and how, not can you, but how are you going to lead and guide me through this, Father? I trust you, but how are you going to accomplish this? That promise of needing nothing is just, I like that idea of not needing anything. And as we've all found out, the grass has found out, getting thirsty around the countryside, water's kind of a key to that, isn't it? Water is a pretty big need for all of us in any way, shape, and form. We can stay calm thinking about water and however much of it we have, and other things in life and however much of it we have, with Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Philippians 4, 6. Have I remembered today to lay my list of needs, what I believe and trust our needs, at my Father's feet? You are God, I am not. Help. Here. And then have I also remembered, as importantly or more importantly, God, I've seen your answers to yesterday's and the day before's and last week's prayers. Thank you, Father, for these answers to all these prayers that you've blessed me with. Thank you so much for being a loving Heavenly Father that still loves me as your son or as your daughter. It's a pretty awesome thing to stop and think about. I am a loved child of the Creator of all the universe, everything in it. And I get to be his son. And you ladies, you can say, I get to be his daughter. That's pretty awesome when you stop and, whew, whoa, wow, you love me that much. Pretty cool. And the water of life for the thirst for our spirit and our connection with God, I think that water of life is where we find that connection of God and the tool that he uses for it. And that water of life helps our spirit life grow. In Proverbs chapter 18, verse 14, gives us a good reminder with everything going on in the news and whatnot especially. Proverbs 18, verse 14, the human spirit can endure a sick body, but who can bear a crushed spirit? With everything and all the talk that you hear around right now, do you think this might be something impacting our world and different lives around us, even our own personal lives in some ways at different times? How is this affecting me and all those loved ones, all of my loved ones, wherever they are at in this world? Have I remembered to pray for them, to lift them up as a need to my Heavenly Father today? Each one of those that I love around the world, wherever they're at. Our Father's love for us, I believe, is with this, part of it is with this water of life. In Psalms chapter 36, verses 7 to 8, really struck me as some good joy here. How precious is your unfailing love, O God. All humanity finds shelter in the shadow of your wings. You feed them from the abundance of your own house, letting them drink from your river of delights. Psalm 36, verse 7 to 8. Can I remember each day, regardless of what things might come down the pipeline at me, that my Heavenly Father has a river of delights and the door is open to it each day? When things get heavy on your shoulders, I can just be like, oh, God, why is this happening? Why does this have to happen now? What is going on here? Or is it, hey, it doesn't matter that this is happening. I can see the river over there, and I know I can go drink in that awesome river of delights because I am your loved daughter. I am your loved son. How awesome is this? I don't believe that he wants us to be thirsty in any area of our life. Our physical life, he doesn't want us to be thirsty. Our emotional life, I don't believe he wants us to be thirsty in. And especially our spiritual life. I don't believe our Heavenly Father wants us to thirst in our spirit, man. He wants to have that personal one-on-one connection and relationship with us. And even though he doesn't want us to be thirsty, will he allow times of dryness come into our lives and for us to experience dryness in any one of those three areas, physical, emotional, or spiritual? But when he does, it might be a bit of a trial to allow us to grow in that area, in our faith and our trust in him. That God, I really feel dry in this area of my life. I need a drink of water. And then at just the right time, through whatever miraculous things he puts in motion, here comes the friend. Hey, you look thirsty. Would you like a drink of water today? You could join me with this if you like this. It's amazing how he can put all those pieces in place for us. And we'll just have the faith and trust that it can happen. Because for myself personally, and I believe for each one of us, those times can help us grow and connect with him on a deeper level. Have I spent as much time on my knees doing this and in communication with him when things are, popping and good and happy and joyful? Or has my more intimate times of connection been with, God, I need breath in my lungs for this next few days, for some clear thinking over this situation going on in life right now. Please lead me and guide me. I know for me personally, which one has sparked a lot more intense conversation with God. And so, I know he allows those times to come into my life for our relationship to grow. And then I hope I can be remembering to thank him for, thank you for leading me through this dry time and providing the power of your water of life in my life right now, God. And something else that struck me as we were praying and preparing for this message was the, it's good to remember that the intensity with which the water in our lives comes into us, and comes to us, the intensity level of that can have a really big impact on things, can't it? Has anyone gotten to put roads back in this spring or this summer at all yet? Several times? The intensity of the water that comes into our life, it can be, I mean, that powerful intensity, like the evangelist up here, the person that, you know, let's get to know Jesus, people, we got to know God now, and you know, yeah, there's, you see some people's lives changed quick and in a hurry, and it's good, but it's quick and it floods through and rushes away, but that soft, gentle, steady rain that sets in and you get the inch of rain that a lot of us have gotten in 20 minutes, it's spread out over 2 days, a nice, just gentle, flowing, consistent river of love flowing from God through each one of our lives, into each one of our lives, and through our lives into other people's lives on a daily basis. That soft, gentle rain, which one brings up more green grass? When do we see the life pop up from the earth around us? That good, soft, steady flow of gentle rain through that daily communion with God and that daily relationship with God and his love flowing into my life through each one of your lives into my life and his love flowing into my life out hopefully to your lives and to everyone's lives that I get to interact with each day. A good steady flow will provide more life and more growth for people's physical and more importantly emotional and most importantly their spiritual life. Each one of us is a river of love and a testimony to the world around us for what God's love can do in a life. It's pretty neat to think about and think, okay, the best sermons preached are lives well lived and lives properly lived in accordance with God's will for them, from what my understanding of it. So have I been a good sermon preached to everyone that I've been around today? In Isaiah verse 43, or chapter 43, verse 19, we're reminded, "For I am about to do something new. See, I have already begun. Do you not see it? I will make a pathway through the wilderness. I will create rivers in the dry wasteland." Isaiah 43, verse 19. God's got some big plans, doesn't he? He can use his water of life to accomplish those big plans and to have the life that he wants to see on earth grown. All the spiritual life around each one of us and in each one of us has the opportunity to grow, the more opportunity it has to be watered with that water of life. Am I making sure I'm keeping my seed anchored and planted close to that water of life? Or do I ever get distracted and, oh, there's this over here. Oh, there's this over here. And pretty soon, the seed crosses the water of life once in a while, but it's not anchored close to it. If I stay anchored close to that water of life that God has for me, and for each one of us, our spiritual seed can grow and burst into the most magnificent big spiritual tree that God wants us to be. And a good key to remember too, I think, as well as Romans chapter 8, verse 28. "And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them." Romans 8, verse 28. So everything that comes into my life, good, bad, pretty, ugly, indifferent, whatever it is, God has allowed that to come into my life, and everything that comes into each of our lives, God allows that to come into our lives. And it gives us the opportunity to grow in our relationship and our faith and trust in him in that area. One other little bit of a bunny trail, but something that struck me was President Trump's speech to us over on July 4th up at Mount Rushmore. I thought he gave a great speech celebrating four great Americans, some great Americans that were up on those rocks. And it struck me with what he said, and just put the exclamation point behind what Pastor Bill had said, aka dad to some of us, had said last week, and has said several times, that my grandma drilled into his head and anchored in his head and his heart, don't tell me what you can't do, just do it. So am I focusing on being an American? Have I anchored myself on wanting to be an American? Because I don't want to be an Americant. I don't want any part of all the Americants going on, and all that chaos. I just want to be an American, knowing that I can go forth and do it, because I can do all things and all this through Christ who strengthens me. I'll remember to give him the glory and give him all the thanks and the praise for it. God, I know you can get me through this and that you can help me achieve your goal in this situation. Something else that's weighed on my head and my heart. How can I eliminate that fun little four-letter word, can't, from my vocabulary, from my family's vocabulary? Encourage my friends to help them eliminate it from their vocabulary, their thinking. What do I allow up here in the thoughts in my head? Are they can't thoughts, or are they I can thoughts? I can do this. Proverbs chapter 4, verses 20 to 23, in the GNT version. My child, pay attention to what I say. Listen to my words. Never let them get away from you. Remember them and keep them in your heart. They will give life and health to anyone who understands them. Be careful how you think. Your life is shaped by your thoughts. Proverbs 4, verses 20 to 23. So what am I allowing to anchor up here? Because it's going to be part of the river that comes out of me, and I want to be a river of the water of life. I think another key part that hit my heart was to be a solid river of the water of life, to be part of that flow. You need to stay close to a fresh water source, don't you? Is the water that mixes in with the ocean right there, with the marshes in Louisiana, is that that good crystal clear fresh mountain water that starts those rivers off flowing to the ocean? Probably not so much. There's that good salt water brackish mix there. To be a good pure water of life flow, you want to stay close to that good pure spring of water, don't you? And sufficient fresh water from the source. One of the area we can anchor on would be John chapter 7, verses 37 to 38. On the last day, the climax of the festival, Jesus stood and shouted to the crowds, "Anyone who is thirsty may come to me. Anyone who believes in me may come and drink. For the scriptures declare, rivers of living water will flow from his heart." John 7, verses 37 to 38. So there's my encouragement for my spring and my fresh water source right there. Will I remember to come to him on my daily basis and find my fresh water source so I can come forward and help share that fresh water with everyone in my life who needs it? Kids, do you ever need fresh water from dad in your life? Fresh water of love flowing in your life? Moms, dads in the room, I know personally, I love the fresh water of the light of love, that water of life that can flow into my life through them, and then to pass that on down to my own kids. We each have that opportunity to do that, not just with parents and siblings and family, but the whole world around us. We have that opportunity for the water of love to flow through my life into the lives of all those around me. Sometimes the best water of love we can do might be the only water of love we can do for this person or that this person might get for the day. When they see this, that can be the biggest spark and inspiration of love for a person that they might get in the course of a whole day. That poor rundown person at the checkout line, big city or big store, wherever you're at, or the local gas station, wherever, might just be having one of those days like, ugh, But when they see you come in, have a blessed day, sir. Have a blessed day now. That smile, I know personally, when I see a smile, it's like, yeah, all right. They just got that little bit better. Enough of those smiles, that little bit better stacks up pretty quick, doesn't it? So, as we have this river of water of life flowing through us and into us, who all are we allowed to bless this water of life with? Is it something that I need to hold on to? Because I don't want to be thirsty, you know? I'm sure none of you want to be thirsty, right? In any one of the three areas of life. Who am I allowed to share this water of life with in the form of love? Revelation 22, verse 17 jumped out and spoke to me for this. The Spirit and the Bride say, come. Let anyone who hears this say, come. Let anyone who is thirsty come. Let anyone who desires drink freely from the water of life. Revelation 22, verse 17. So right there is my list of anyone to share the water of life, the water of love with. Anyone. Which kind of, it could also be everyone, I think, included with that anyone. So I need to try to share the water of life with everyone around me, in whatever way it can be. Whatever, you know, however God chooses to flow his love through you and through your life into other people. Am I willing to be open to that? One note that jumped out at me too with this verse and all the verses prior to this about people being thirsty in the water of life. Did anyone notice whose responsibility it was in each one of those? There's a big level of personal responsibility for fulfilling that thirst being quenched, the water of life. God doesn't say, oh, don't worry, my daughter. Yes, when you're thirsty, I will dump gallons of water over your head. All you have to do is open your mouth a little bit. I will pour and flood gallons of water over you. He doesn't do that, does he? What does he say? Anyone who's thirsty may come to the river, may come to you. Jesus says, you know, people can come to me. So there's that personal responsibility that I'm responsible if I'm thirsty in one of those three areas of my life. I need to make sure that I'm on my feet or on my knees, whatever situation, whatever avenue answers that situation, and try to fulfill what God's leading and guiding me to do. And everyone else around me, everyone we see on any flat screens and everything, is it my responsibility to flood them with the water of life? It's their responsibility to say, I'm thirsty, and come and find the drink of the water of life for themselves. I can't force people to have their spiritual thirsts quenched with my knowledge of, or my way of spiritual thirst quenching. But if they're thirsty enough, and they want to seek it, and will come and find it, I can be that open river of the water of life for all who are open and willing to seek it. So they have that personal responsibility there, I think, the way that I've read them, all the scriptures. And can they see the river of the water of life flowing through me into their lives or into the lives of others? Someone who is thirsty might stand back a little bit and say, okay, I hear what they're saying and talking about, but is what he's saying being lived out and flowing into the lives of others? If they see that, someone's a whole lot more likely to come up to you and say, it seems like you might have an answer to a problem that I have. We've got this small issue. I have a friend, right? I have this friend, and if you could provide me the answer for this friend. Has anyone ever had that? Someone tell them that? I need this answer for this friend. When really deep down, you know it's probably the answer that they need in their own heart. I know I've said that to people at different times. I need an answer for a friend. Can you help me out for my friend's sake? When really it was was the friend needing the answer. And it's just, I'm not wanting to humble the self to say, okay, I need help. It's just, someone else I know needs help. Can you tell me how to help them? But I'll just remember to live the life of love as fully as I can each 24 hours. And remember to shake the hand firmly and smile and say, hey, have a blessed day, friend. Thank you for your help today. Thank you for the services you provided. You can help be the love of Christ coming into their life for that 5 minutes, or 10 minutes, or however long it is, 2 seconds. And with the water that's flowing into and from my life, I can, and all those whose lives take in his water of life, I believe all of us can be impacted with Isaiah 35, verse 7. It's a good example, or a good definition of what happens when we're living in that water of life. Isaiah 35, 7. The parched ground will become a pool, and springs of water will satisfy the thirsty land. Marsh grass and reeds and rushes will flourish where desert jackals once lived. Isaiah 35, verse 7. Am I remembering to, okay, things can be a beautiful marsh, an awesome, magnificent marsh area, if I'll remember to stay in that water of life and not let the areas, any one of those three areas of my life dry out. And try hard to not let any one of those three areas, and my loved ones, my family, my friends, my people, to come into my life however they come into it. Can I help each one of them have a fully watered life? And something else, when the rain pours, however fast it pours, right? If the inch decides to kindly take 2 days to arrive, or if the inch just decides in 20 minutes it's going to be there, however it comes, can I remember when it rains to look for the rainbow? When the sun sets each night, look up in the dark sky and all the darkness that surrounds and see the beauty of the magnificent stars surrounding us? Have I taken the time to find the good parts in everything around me over the last 24 hours? Regardless of what it might be like, there's going to be some good and some beauty in every circumstance and situation. In Psalm chapter 34, verse 1, I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praises. And my daughter will come up and bless us with a song now. Maybe help stay focused and anchored on some of this. It's called Oceans by Hillsong United. As encouragement for each of us when times of dryness in any area of our life come upon us.
And I will call upon your
Thank you so very much, daughter dear. Ms. Tyler Ann, do we have any prayer requests that we'd like to lift up to our Heavenly Father this morning?
There was one from the comments. It was a prayer for Anthony Novak and Christian Novak and their son Grayson. They lost everything in the tornado.
Anthony and Christian?
Anthony Novak, Christian Novak, and their son Grayson.
Anthony, Christian, and Grayson.
Yes.
Novak.
Yes.
Novak, sorry. Anthony, Christian, and
Grayson.
I'm a slow writer. In the face by a horse, receiving some miraculously quick recovery.
Hope's having some trouble with her prosthetic hip and knee. Not quite sure what the prognosis is for that, but keep praying for it.
Full and complete recovery for Hope. Marlene Janice and her family. And anyone having any head issues at all, headache issues? Okay, we have a good solid list that we can stand in faith on that God will provide some answers for this week. So let's lift all these up to our Heavenly Father this morning. Father God, we just thank you so much again for this day to gather together, to fellowship together, and to study your word and learn about your love for us and how we can spread your love to each other and to all of those around us around the world, Father. We just pray, Father, and ask for your love and your answers to flood over for Anthony and Christian and Grace, Christine and Grayson Novak. And Father, just provide your wisdom and counsel and guidance for them to lead them through this time of their life. They've had this struggle show up. Father, we just lift up both Sarah Moreland and Hope Kaltenbach, asking for their full recoveries from what they're walking through and getting to walk through. That their faith in you and trust in you can grow, and that all of our own faiths and trust in you can grow, seeing their recoveries. Father, we just lift up Marlene Janice and her family, and also the Stellick family, and ask for your spirit of comfort and peace and just settling, going over, flooding over each family member in this time where they have to say, hopefully, see you later to a family member, and just trust that they are in your hands, Father. We just thank you for your spirit of peace and comfort flooding over them. We lift up Rael, Father, and ask for just peace and comfort and the elimination of the bad headaches she's dealing with, and any one of our church family dealing with any headache issues or head trauma issues. We just pray for your spirit of healing and restoration and recovery flooding over them. Father, we also just thank you for the rain, and we ask and request for a good, long, slow rain, Father. The inch to come over several days instead of 20 minutes, first responders, all of our police, our ambulance drivers, all of our firefighters. We thank you for providing wisdom and grace and safety and protection for all of them. We ask for wisdom and guidance and counsel for all of our military. We pray for wisdom and safety and guidance for our president and our vice president, their families, their wives and children. And for, we lift up all of our fellow prayer warriors, wherever they are at, that their hearts can stay in tune and focus on you. We thank you that each of us can be your body that can, Father, that we're a body of cans, and that we can go accomplish your will for us. We thank you for this, Father, in Jesus' name, with the prayer that he taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift you up and give you peace. Go forth and enjoy living out a river of love.